Greetings in the blessed name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Hi, this is Pastor Bobby Paul. I'd like to welcome you today to the internet broadcast of Albany Family Worship Center. Albany Family Worship Center is located at 3024 Kensington Court here in Albany, Georgia. Our service times are Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for midweek Bible study and Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m. for morning worship. I hope this message encourages you today and draws you ever closer to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Have a blessed day, and always remember this: Jesus loves you.
So let me ask you a question. How many of you got a Bible this morning? Hold them up. Let me see them. If you ain't got a Bible, grab a pew Bible. Somebody shout amen. Let's go to Galatians. Galatians in the New Testament. I want you to find chapter number 2. Galatians, chapter number 2. When you find chapter number 2, go down to the 9th verse. And we're going to be talking about today living without a doubt. Living without a doubt. Because I believe we all struggle with doubt in some area of our life. Am I talking to anybody this morning? Say amen. So if everybody's in Galatians chapter 2, verse 9, say amen. If you would stand out of reverence for the reading of the Word of God. Galatians 2, verse 9. For in him, meaning in Jesus, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And ye, somebody look at your neighbor and said, he's talking to me. And ye are complete in him. Wow, that's an awesome statement, isn't it? And ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. So saith the word of God today. Father, bless the reading of this word. Father, use this living and powerful word to impact our lives. The Holy Spirit begin to move right now. Use this word to strengthen us, to encourage us, to increase our faith, and draw us closer to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Use it to take away the doubt this morning. Use it to give us the ability to stand fast and stand firm in our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, despite the situations, despite the storms, despite the discouragement that we face, knowing that we have the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and knowing that this too shall pass. Father God, we love you today, and we praise you, and we give you glory. And God, as I stand before you right now, I just ask you, Lord, to take control of me. Father, I humble myself under your mighty hand. And God, I give control to you today, Father God. Holy Spirit, I ask you, Lord, right now to come and let your words be my words, your thoughts my thoughts, your love in my heart, Jesus, that it flows out and touches everyone in this room. In Jesus' name we pray and say, we love you, Jesus. Amen and amen and amen. You may be seated and give God a hand clap of praise. Jesus said these words in John 8:22, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Now, the freedom he's talking about here is not a freedom from financial difficulties. It's not a freedom to get things in this world, but it is a freedom he's talking about here that is a freedom from the sin of doubts of bondage in your life. The freedom to know that this word right here is true from the first in the beginning to the last, amen. Because when we doubt, we sin. That is why it's so important as a child of God. We need to understand, now listen now, and apply the Word of God to our life, because it sets us free. It sets us free from the sin of doubt. It keeps us from questioning our Lord and Savior, and keeps us walking the path that He has set our feet upon. You see, when we don't have a firm understanding of the Word of God, you cannot apply it correctly to your life. See, it's one thing to speak this word. It's one thing to quote this word. It's something entirely different when you apply it to your life through faith in Jesus Christ. Am I making sense to anybody? Say amen. And let me tell you something. Doubt, when you doubt this word, when you doubt our Savior, when you doubt the greatness of our God, it's the biggest cause of sin in our life, because doubt is sin. Doubt causes you not to trust Jesus. And without a complete faith in Jesus Christ, we have nothing on which to stand. We have no firm foundation. And the least little bit of storm, the least little bit of wind, the least little bit of problem, the least little bit of controversy, we fall. Am I making sense to anybody? Say amen. We can't doubt. Your relationship with Jesus is weakened through doubt, and you find yourself in a constant turmoil because of all that is going on in life. You have no peace, you have no assurances, and you have no hope for the here and now and for your future. And I want to speak one of the greatest truths in the Word of God to you right now is this: for in Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, in Jesus. Somebody say in Jesus. Not in the denomination, not in your emotions, not in your feelings, not in the things of this world, but in Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you, child of God, are complete in Him. Have you ever just felt in your life that something is missing? Come on, somebody talk to the preacher today. You ever felt like something is missing? I'm going to tell you what that something was. That is a deep relationship with Jesus Christ. And we as human beings, we try everything in the world we can to fill up what we feel is missing. We don't know what it is, but we try everything. Y'all don't look at me so sanctimonious. Y'all know y'all been down that road before. But it's not until we come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, or filled with His Spirit, that we know true completeness, because we are complete in Him. Do you understand that? You have all you need in Jesus Christ despite the things that's going on in your life. I don't think nobody got a hold of that. You have everything you need in your life through Jesus Christ, despite everything else that's going on. Because greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. Amen? We are more than conquerors through Christ who loves us. And we need to get a hold of that today. When you understand this, you always know. Somebody say no. You see, we're too quick. Well, I hope so. Or maybe. Or I think I am. Come on now. But when you're grounded and founded in the truth with no doubt, you understand this. You always know where you stand with your Lord and Savior. You always know that you will have what you need to face and endure any situation you come up against. And you always know that the promises in His Word will come to pass in your life, no matter what the world, the devil, or man says. And if you'll give me just a few minutes, we ain't got to the sermon yet, by the way. And if you'll give me just a few minutes, I would like to talk to you about three areas in our life that we all struggle with doubt in the most. And if you'll listen closely in one of these three areas, you're going to find yourself sitting today. And one of these three areas, you're going to find yourself struggling today. And the first area is this: your relationship with Jesus Christ. I've heard too many people come say, well, you know, I went down to the altar one time and I said a prayer with the preacher, then he dunked me in the water and I got baptized, and I hope I'm saved. Well, guess what? If you're saying, I think I'm saved, or I hope I'm saved, or maybe I'm saved, or let me tell you something, you may not be saved today. Because when you're born again, a child of God, you know that you're saved. How do I know that? Because from the moment that I confessed with my mouth and believed in my heart the Lord Jesus Christ, I've never doubted my salvation. I've never doubted what he has promised me. Now, I've doubted sometimes that if I was going in the right direction, if I was doing the right thing, but I've never doubted my salvation experience. Because when you're born again, you know it. Hello? You changed. Hello? You're changed. You're no longer what you were. The Bible says that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Are you a new creation? All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Has there been a change in your life? And if there's been a change in your life, you should not question your relationship with Jesus Christ. You should not question your salvation. But so many people do. Or better yet, when things begin to come along and things begin to happen and they're not going the way we want them to go, we really wonder, well, are we really what we're supposed to be? Let me tell you what, if you're what you're supposed to be in the Lord Jesus Christ, a blood-bought, born-again child of God, walking by faith and not by sight, trusting in him completely, leaning not on your own understanding, but leaning on him and everything in your life, there's going to be situations come up. Because the devil hates you and he wants to bring you down. The world's not going to understand you. People around you are going to think you're crazy. Amen? But you can know today. And if Jesus Christ is your Lord and Savior today, if you're a born-again child of God today, you can have assurance. The first thing you can have assurance for is this. You are no longer an outcast or an enemy of God. Hello? See, before you got saved, before you got into a relationship with Jesus, before he applied the blood to your life and forgive you of all your sins and washed you clean, and cast those sins as far as the east is from the west and began to call you child. See, you was an outcast and an enemy. Well, preacher, I don't consider myself an enemy of God. Well, you were, because the Bible says you were. Hello? You wasn't for him. And if you wasn't for him, you had to be against him. Hello? Galatians 1:21 says, in you, when I point my finger, a lot of people say, well, you picking on me. No, you always got to remember, when I point a finger at you, that means there's three more pointing back at me, amen? That God has already convicted me of these things before I bring the word to you. It says, Galatians 1:21, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he hath reconcile. See, when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus Christ, when you surrender to him and you're saved by grace through faith and that not of yourself, you are reconciled and brought back into a right relationship with Jesus Christ. Ephesians 1:7 says, in whom, in Jesus, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sin according to the riches of his grace. If you meant it, so did he. And I think he means it more than we do. And he proves it when he died on the cross, when he shed his blood for the redemption of our sins, when he rose from that grave on the third day to become the cornerstone of our faith. And when we come to him and we humble ourselves under that mighty hand of God and we ask for forgiveness, we turn from sin and self and we turn to him, we are forgiven and reconciled and brought back into a right relationship with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Can somebody give him a little praise in the house of God? And after that happens, you are now given the position Listen, the position of a child with God as your Lord, as your heavenly Father. See, you're no longer an outcast. You're no longer a vagabond, but you are now a child of God. It says in Romans 8, 14 through 16, for as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. See, the day we get saved, the day we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit of God, the Spirit of Jesus, the Spirit of the living God comes to take up residence in our heart. And if we will give him control, if we will let him have his will and way with us, he will take us and lead us and guide us through all aspects of our life. The Bible teaches that if we have nothing to do with the Holy Spirit, we reject the Holy Spirit, we're no longer Christ. Hello? And when we give that Holy Spirit control, the Bible says this, when we walk in the Spirit, that word walk means when we live, when we abide, when we are consumed by that Holy Spirit, when we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. We walk as God calls us to walk. Am I making sense to anybody in this house today? But he said, if any are led by the Spirit of God, are you letting the Holy Spirit have control of you today? For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons, that is the children of God, the sons, the daughters of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption. God now calls you his child. You have been adopted by God. You have received the spirit of adoption by which... whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself, the Spirit himself, bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. See, that's why it's so important to give the Holy Ghost control, because he bears witness with our spirit that we won't, that listen, that we don't doubt that we're the children of God now. That God's got his hands on us. And I don't know of any father, good father, a father who's what he's supposed to be, does not see about his children. When my children need, they get. When my children have a want, if it's necessary, they get it. Amen. If they're sick, they get medicine. If they're hungry, they get food. If they need clothing, they get clothes. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? And because he is such a righteous God, a holy God, a just God, God sees to our needs according to his riches in glory. I have not seen the righteous wanting. You may not be eating caviar and T-bone steak, but I guarantee you find some peanut butter and jelly in the house to fill the hot spot. Amen. You may not be wearing the latest from Saks Fifth Avenue, but I guarantee you this, Kmart or Walmart will cover you up. Amen? Praise God. You know, we place too much emphasis on clothes. I know kids that don't want to go to school because they don't have the latest shoe that everybody's wearing or the latest pair of pants that everybody's wearing. That is one of the most foolish things in the world. Look here, I grew up wearing stuff like Tough Nut and Kids, amen? And I was proud to have it. I didn't have what everybody else had, but I was covered up, amen? Because my mama and daddy made sure I was covered, made sure I had what I had and what I needed. And that's the way our Lord and Savior does. He sees that we had for what we need. When you are called by the name of God, you are called child. Amen. You are called by his name, blessed and highly favored by your heavenly Father. Isaiah 56, 5 says, even unto them will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than of sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. You are not called by the name of the Most High God, Jesus Christ. You call yourself a Christian? Hello? A Christian, C-H-R-I-S-T-I-A-N-I-A-N, is a Latin suffix meaning belonging to. You now belong to Jesus. And not as a slave, but as a child. Amen. And he will see to you. You as a child of the Most High God have the right given to you through your relationship and position with Jesus Christ to all that God has to offer today. I get so upset with children of God when things are going on in their life and they say, well, he might have done it for brother so-and-so, but I don't think he's going to do it for me. How many of you ever done that before? Well, guess what? You just doubted God and you spoke a lie. Because if God does it for one, he'll do it for another. Hello? Because God doesn't love one child more than he loves another. He loves everybody the same. Everybody's the same in the eyes of God. Do you understand what I'm saying to you today? And you can't, listen, as a child of the Most High God, you have the right given to you through your relationship and through your position with Jesus with all that God has to offer today. It says in Romans 8:17, and if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Titus 3:7 said that being justified by grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. God's got it. He'll give it to you, amen, when you have need of it. But so oftentimes when we begin to go through things and we begin to cry out and things don't happen like we want it to happen, and we begin to say, Lord, why is this happening to me? Because God's trying to glorify himself through you if you'll just trust in him. When Jesus healed the blind man, his disciples asked him, said, Lord, this man was blind. Who sinned, him or his parents? And Jesus said, neither. This happened so God might be glorified. Amen. Through every situation you go through, when you don't doubt God, when you are delivered at the end of it, it's to bring him honor and glory and to show you just how powerful a God you serve. Can somebody hear what I'm saying today? Trying to help you with your doubt. Because everything you need is in Jesus. You are an heir to all that God has to offer. You're a joint. Am I making sense to anybody today? Say amen. You an heir with Jesus. You an heir to God and a joint heir with Jesus. If he done it for Brother Wonderful, he'll do it for you. If he done it for Sister Bertha better than you, he'll do it for you. Amen. You just can't doubt. The problem is we doubt. Amen. In the midst of your storm, Jesus will stand in the bow of your boat and say, peace, be still. Sometimes you just got to walk it out, church. One step at a time. Get away from those things. See, the world wants to draw you out from under the covering of Jesus Christ. The world will offer you everything that feels good, looks good, and tastes good. Hello? Just to bring you out from under the covering, to cause you to doubt. Well, you know something? I'm having such a good time over here. It feels so good over here. It tastes so good over here. You know, Jesus ain't been doing it. But you know something? These folks have been doing it for me. And, you know, I'm going to keep on right here. I'm not going back away. But all of a sudden, you find yourself in a position where you crash to the floor and nobody from the world, nobody that brought you there is there to help pick you up. And if you'll turn back to Jesus, he will step in and lift you above that flood you're in right now. Lift you above that famine you're facing right now. Am I talking to somebody in this house today? And he will give you what you need. Why? Because if you have confessed with your mouth and believed in your heart the Lord Jesus Christ, you are now an heir and a joint heir of Jesus. You are now a child of God. And you are entitled. You listen, he's got everything you need. Amen. And furthermore, when you don't have a doubt, listen, our God, our Savior will manifest himself to you when you apply his living word to our life. You know, so many children, so many people today that call themselves children of God, they say, well, where is God? Why has he forsaken me? Why has he left me out here by myself? Why? Because you got nothing under his covering. God ain't going nowhere. God's where he's always been. He's on the throne. You just started doubting and not applying that word to your life. Am I making sense to anybody this morning? Jesus said these words in John 14, 21. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, it is he that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him, listen, and will manifest myself to him. When you stop applying this word to your life and you start living in sin, how do you expect a holy and righteous and just God to manifest himself to you? How do you expect to hear his voice? How do you expect to feel his hand in your life when you're living contrary to everything he's taught you? Am I making sense to you? Say amen. But when you apply this word to your life, he will manifest himself to you. He said in John 14, 23, if any man love me, do you love Jesus today? If any man love me, he it is that loveth me, and he that loveth me shall be loved. But listen, if any man love me, he will keep my words. Do you love him? Keep his word, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. I don't know about y'all, but when I abode with my Father when I was coming up, I didn't have anything to worry about. Hello? We wasn't rich by no means, but we had what we needed when we needed. Because I abode in my Father's house. I abode with my Father. I abode up under my Father's instructions. I abode up under his authority. And when you do that with Jesus, when you abode under his authority, when you abode in his instructions, when you abode in his word, he will come and pour out blessings on you. You've got to learn to apply this word to your life. This is the reason so many people wonder where God is. They fail to understand and apply the word of truth to their life. Because he's always promised that no matter what we face, he will always be with us to see us through and to give us the victory. Give us the victory through our faith in Jesus Christ. If we're willing to abode, if we're willing to apply. Isaiah 43, 1 through 3 says this, now thus saith the Lord God that created thee, O Jacob, he that formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed thee. I have called thee by name, thou art mine. When thou passest through the water, I will be with thee, and through the river they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, they shall not be burned, neither shall flame kindle upon thee. Now let me tell you something. As you read, you're going to notice something. He says, when you go through these things, not that you're not going to go through them. How many of you are going through a hard time right now? Facing difficulties right now? He says this, when you go through these things, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee, for I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior, thy Deliverer, thy Rescuer. The one that when you lean on him completely, he will see you through. It says in Hebrews 13:14, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So stop doubting when things come up. Stop doubting God's power and authority in your life. In him, you are complete. The next area we worry about, we doubt God in, is this. And that is that our needs will be taken care of through his power and glory. How many know there's nothing impossible for God? Oh, come on, that was weak. How many of you know that nothing's impossible for God today? That through God, all things are possible. And God has promised that he will see to our needs. Not our desires, not our lust, but our needs. He will see to our needs when we trust in him. If you have need of it, he'll supply it. But my God shall supply for all your need according to his riches in glory. The psalmist says in Psalm 23:1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The shepherd sees to the need of his sheep. They need feeding, they get fed. If they need water, they are watered. If they need protection, he protects. And God will do the same for you today. Our heavenly Father and Savior will not let us go needing. He will not let us go needing. He will give to us freely and without reservation. But you cannot doubt, child of God. You have to know that this truth will come to pass. Why? Because the God we serve cannot lie. Hello? Jesus says in Matthew 11:28, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I will give you what you need. I will give you completion in your life. Why? Because in him we're complete. Nowhere else. You've got to learn to turn and run to him. He says in Isaiah 40:11, he shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm and carry them in his bosom and shall gently lead those that are with young. Church, I'm here to tell you this morning that God's amazing grace has all you need today. I want to say that again. God's amazing grace has all you need today to get you through the needy times of your life. Do you get that this morning? Do you receive that this morning? It says in 2 Corinthians 9:8, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things and may abound to every good work. God's got what you need today. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, he told Paul, he said, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Some of us are too prideful to run to the throne of grace. Well, I can handle it. I don't need nobody to pray for me. I don't need nobody to help for me. I've done it this long by myself. I can keep on going. I don't need anybody. I'm sorry, but we all need somebody. I need Jesus. Amen. I need you to help pray for me. I need to help pray for you. Amen. We need to come together as the body of Christ, because when we come together as the body of Christ in unity, things begin to happen. Because if one person with the faith of a grain of a mustard seed can tell a mountain to move from here to there, what will happen when 20, 30, 40, or 1,000 people like that get together? Come on, think about it for a minute. God's grace is sufficient. He said, my strength is made perfect. The problem is we won't humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt us in due time. We'd rather struggle. Hello? Well, I don't want to bother nobody. I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to bother you. Amen? I'm going to bother Jesus. I'm going to keep knocking and knocking and knocking until he opens the door on something. Amen? I'm not ashamed to say, hey, pray for me. I'll pick up the phone in a minute and call somebody to pray for me. Amen. Because I know that when God's grace goes to be poured out in your life, things begin to happen because there's sufficiency, listen, in the grace of God. Don't doubt God's ability to meet your needs. Not only will he see to them, but guess what he can do? He can exceed them. How do I know that? Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Doubt throws the provisions of God out the window in your life. Don't doubt God. Don't doubt God. And finally, can't doubt the promises of God. When God makes you a promise, God means it. When this word says it, you can go to bank on it. Amen? Look here. This word's for you. This word's for me. Somebody look at your neighbor and said, that word's for me. You can build your life on this. There's no error in here. And when you rightly divide this word of truth, when you study to show yourself approved, God honors that. You can't doubt the promises of God. Do not doubt the promises of God that he's given you in this word. Remember, our God cannot lie. Our God cannot tell a lie. When he speaks the truth. Amen. It says in Numbers 23:19, God is not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. He has said it, and shall he not do it? Or hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? Titus 1:2 says, in the hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie promised before the world began. God's got what you need today. Only thing we got to do is get a hold of this promise and don't doubt. Well, what happened in the Garden of Eden? When the devil come to Eve and he said, did God really say? See, that's how it all starts. We begin to question or doubt what God is saying in this word. Because this word is truth. Jesus said, thy word is truth. Sanctify them with thy truth. We got to get a hold of this and remember the promises of God are for you. They're not for anybody else. They're not for everybody but you. Hello? See, we think the promises of God is for everybody but us. Well, I don't deserve it. I'll just suffer because I don't deserve to be blessed. I don't deserve to be healed. I don't deserve to be strengthened. I don't deserve to be encouraged. I just let somebody else have it. I'll just tough it out. Doubter! So you're doubting God because it's for you. See, it's a personal letter. That word's a personal letter to you and me and to everybody. And the promises in that word are for you. It's for me. It's for everybody. There's nothing in there that God doesn't. That God looked at and said, "Oh, you don't. Hey, that's really not for you. That's for these people over here. No, that promise is for everybody. Do you get it? Do you get it? It's for everybody. God says it. I believe it. Amen. I take it to heart. And you know what? When I pray sometimes, I let God know I remember what His Word says to me, and I'll say, Lord, you know, you said this in Your Word. And right now I'm standing on this because that promise is for me. And we got to be willing to do that. His promises is for us. When God says it, He means it. He ain't playing a game, church. God ain't playing. When God says it, He's meaning. He's just not saying things to make you feel good. So all the time we think, well, God didn't really mean that. Yeah, He did. God said it. He meant it. He's not playing games with us. He's not trying to make you feel good. He means what He says in His Word. He says what He means, and He means what He says. It says in Psalms 119, 142, thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth. Verse 160 said, thy word is truth from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. The Lord God Almighty, Jesus Christ, the righteous Savior, if He's promised to bless you and He's promised to keep you, He will let His face shine upon you. He will be gracious to you. He will give you peace when you trust in Him completely and do not doubt in your heart, because His word is true. Can you hear what the man of God is saying to you this morning? Numbers 6, 24-26. I love this. It said, the Lord bless thee and keep thee. We say this at the end of every service. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make His face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up His countenance upon thee and give thee peace. That promise is for you. He says in the book of Isaiah, He said, I will heal thee. Whatever you need, He's got today. He promised us in the book of Jeremiah 29 and 11, for I know the thoughts I think toward you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. Thoughts of peace and not of evil. To give you an expecting end. God's got a plan and a blessing for your life. But you got to walk in the truth of this word. You got to apply it to your life. See, God wants to revive you. God wants to refresh you. He says in 2 Chronicles 7, 14, if my people. I got a news flash for you. That's us. If you're a blood-bought, born-again child of God today, you are the people of God. You're a holy nation, a royal priesthood, a peculiar people. You're the people of God. And He makes this promise, if my people, talking to all of us in here today, everyone that's listening by video today, if my people, which are called by my name, listen, shall humble themselves. Are you willing to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that He may exalt you in due time? Is there just a speck of something there, a speck of pride, a speck of stubbornness, a speck of hard-headedness that God wants to remove? To humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and pray. Talk to God. Talk to God. You're a child of God, talk with your Heavenly Father. Have a conversation with Him. Sit down and tell Him how you feel. I guarantee this, if you get a chance to get your buddy or your best friend or your girlfriend or whatever on the phone, your mama, your daddy, your auntie, your uncle, your grandmama, whoever you confide in on the phone, you're gonna spill your guts to them. You're gonna tell them how you feel. Do the same thing with God. Humble yourselves under His mighty hand and pray. Talk to God and seek my face. Seek the face of God. Seek a deeper and more personal and intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. When you say, preacher, how can I seek a closer walk with a righteous and holy and just God when I do things wrong all the time? Repent. Ask Him to forgive you, and He will, and He'll draw you closer. See, that's part of the humbling process. Am I getting through to somebody today? Because He wants to have a relationship with you. He really died on the cross. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Listen now. And turn from their wicked ways. Now look here. Let me. Everybody listen to me say amen. I don't have my glasses on, so I can't see your face, so I ain't going to pick on nobody. I don't have to get a pad and write your sins out and put it in front of your face. I'm talking about those things that you are weak in. the places where you always stumble and fall. I don't have to do that. Because if you're a born-again child of God and the Holy Spirit is in your heart today, He will convict you of all sin and righteousness in your life. You know the areas you're weak in. You know where the devil pushes your buttons. Hello? Am I making sense to you? Say amen. And you got to recognize those places and turn from them. And you got to turn back to Jesus. Turn from your wicked ways. Turn from your sin. Turn from your shortcomings. Turn from your doubts. Am I getting through to anybody? Because I got a news flash for you. You ain't perfect. And neither am I. We all stumble and fall. But see, that's what makes our God so great. Our God's a loving God. Our God's a gracious God. Our God's a merciful God. Our God's a forgiving God. And we turn from sin and self. We turn from our wicked ways. We turn from sin and self. Whatever, I don't care how big or how small, when we turn to Him and say, Lord, forgive me, He does. Instantaneously. We don't have to work them all. You can't work off sin. They got to be washed away by the blood of Jesus. And when you turn to Him, when you turn from your wicked ways, when you humble yourselves, you begin to pray, you begin to seek God's face, you turn from your wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive your sins and will heal your land. And that's a promise I can live with. Amen. But stop doubting. Stop doubting your relationship with Jesus. Stop doubting that He loves you so much that He's going to take care of every need you have. And stop doubting the promises of this word. His word is truth. Amen. And the first promise you can rely on today is this, that Jesus Christ loves you. He died on the cross for you so you can be redeemed. And the only thing you have to do is confess with your mouth and believe in your heart the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. You don't have to doubt. Well, preacher, how can I know? Because He said it. And He don't lie. And it's so simple today, so many people miss it. It's just as easy as saying, Dear Lord Jesus, forgive me, sinner. I turn from sin and self, Jesus, and I turn to You. And right then and right there, He saved you. He cast all your sin as far as the east is from the west. And you know what? There's so many people today that have been born again but have fallen away from God. And they've gotten away from His will and His way in their life. And they don't know how to turn around and come back. They think it's some long, drawn-out process. But that's just as simple as well. When you turn to Lord Jesus and you say, Dear Lord Jesus, I know I've sinned against You. Forgive me, Lord. I turn back to You now. He will restore you. Go read Luke chapter number 15. Read about the prodigal son. It was so easy. When he started home, his father saw him and ran to him and forgave him. Jesus will do the same for you today. And there may be some of you sitting here today, you have a need in your life. It may be a physical need. You may need your body healed. It might be a spiritual need. It might be an emotional need today. Whatever need you have, Jesus is here to meet it according to His riches in glory. But you got to take a step of faith. You got to stop. Preacher, I've been praying this for about a month and ain't nothing happened. Well, keep on praying. God's got a blessing for you. Sometimes you just got to keep knocking. It's going to get opened. Amen. God may be wanting to see how you're going to stand. Whether you're going to just trust Him completely no matter what. Some of the most faithful saints I know have the biggest problems in the world. Hello? Some of the most faithful saints I know are the people with the worst and most problems. Why? Because they trust Jesus so completely. And little by little, He brings them out. little by little, they get where they're going. I'm not saying God can't move instantaneously. He can. But most time he makes us walk it out. Are you hearing me? Sometimes you just got to walk it out. You got to lean not on your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him. Are you willing to do that this morning? Are you willing to trust in Jesus completely? Are you willing to say, Lord, here I am. Lord, I've been doubting. I realize that now, Lord. I realize that doubt has been hindering your blessings in my life. But Lord, right now, I'm turning to you. I'm stepping away from doubt. And I'm stepping into faith. I'm just going to trust you, Lord, with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and all my strength. And I'm going to give you control. Will you do that this morning? Will you say, Lord, here I am. I trust you completely right now for all things. I'm no longer doubting, but I trust you. And if you'll do that, God will begin to move. And you'll see things begin to change in your life. Am I making sense to you? Say amen, please. But it's up to you. See, if I could unscrew the top of your head and take it off and pour a bucket of faith in, I would. Well, really, true, you wouldn't need a bucket. You just need a mustard seed. A mustard seed kind of thing. And that's not a quantity, but it is a quality. A mustard seed kind of thing. And God will move on your behalf. Amen. All heads are bowed. All eyes are closed. There's nobody looking around. This is your time.
Hi, this is Pastor Bobby Paul again. I hope you enjoyed today's message. It has encouraged and drawn you ever closer to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And there may be some of you out there today that's made a decision of faith. That is the decision to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And it's so simple to do today. The Bible teaches us that if we'll just confess with our mouth and believe in our heart the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved. For whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you can call upon him right now by saying this simple prayer of faith. Say, Dear Lord Jesus, forgive me, a sinner. Right now, Lord, I turn from sin and self, and I turn to you, Jesus, and I ask you to come into my heart and be my Lord and Savior. Lord Jesus, I give you all authority, control, and care of my life. Be my Lord and Savior forevermore. I love you, Jesus. Amen. If you just said that prayer, you just become a blood-bought, born-again child of God. And we would love to hear your decision here at Albany Family Worship Center. And here's how you can contact us. You can write us at Albany Family Worship Center, 3024 Kensington Court, Albany, Georgia, 31721. You can send us an email, and our email address is myafwc@gmail.com. That's myafwc@gmail.com. Or you can call us at 229-434-0342. We're looking forward to hearing from you today, and we would love for you to come and visit. We'd love to meet you and the family. Have a blessed day, and always remember this, Jesus loves you.